morning. I wanted to discuss a concept which, if you had told me I would be researching this 10 years ago, I would have said, well, you got the wrong guy. But it's the kind of thing where, you know, you follow your nose and you follow the patients instead of what the books say. So I'm going to just jump right in and talk about a connection between POTS and Ehlers-Danlos type symptoms and something called mast cell activation syndrome. From what I understand on the web, that's called mast cell. It really is more, and those who know what I'm talking about know exactly what I'm talking about. Mast cell activation syndrome, it's complicated. And so I wanted to clear up a few things and just tell you about a connection that we have found and we're working on quite actively right now. So mast cells are the cells in your body that cause trouble when you have an allergic reaction. So when you, if you're allergic to peanut, you eat the peanut, and mast cells all over your body in response to that peanut release a bunch of stuff, including histamine. Now, histamine, we know that you take an antihistamine like Zyrtec or Benadryl, and that can stop it to some extent, but that doesn't stop if you're really having a terrible reaction. It's really not going to stop everything. So mast cells release more things than just histamine. And again, they could release it locally, like in your skin, that's an itch. It can be in your nose, that's why you'd have a stuffy nose. But they release all sorts of stuff. And one of the things that they release is something called tryptase. And tryptase is just another content inside the mast cell. We're not 100% sure what it's supposed to be doing, but the reason why it's helpful for us is because, unlike histamine, it lasts a while in your blood. So you can test to tell, did I just have an anaphylactic reaction to peanut, or did I just pass out because I saw the peanut? And it happens. The serum tryptase can last in your blood for about 4 hours after you have a reaction, if you've had a reaction that mast cells have released things. Interestingly, though, there are some people walking around who have a tryptase that's high. And high, of course, is just what we've decided is high. It doesn't mean that it's high. Your body may not know that it's high, may not care that it's high. But we've just made a cutoff number of, let's say, 11.4 for a high tryptase. And there are people who have a high tryptase, and they have lots of symptoms of a mast cell releasing, but not because they've been exposed to something. It just happens over and over and over again. They start flushing and itching and having crampy abdominal pain, in some cases passing right out. And when someone comes in and says, I'm flushing a lot, I'm itching, I'm having crampy abdominal pain, the doctor, for a long while, an astute physician will go ahead and draw a tryptase because he or she will be worried about a disease called mastocytosis. So mastocytosis is a disorder where you have too many mast cells in your bone marrow, and they're making all of their bad and nasty stuff and causing those symptoms. Well, that's the thing that they're most worried about. But it turns out that there are lots and lots of folks who they go ahead and they find, oh, they had a high tryptase, they have all those symptoms, we're going to do a bone marrow biopsy to check to see if they have mastocytosis, and it turns out their bone marrow is squeaky clean, okay? And so now what do? We have this high tryptase, it's not supposed to be high, they haven't eaten a peanut in the past 2 days, there's no good reason for their tryptase to be high, and yet they're having all of the symptoms that you might expect to see when mast cells are doing bad things. There may be other symptoms, but the main key ones are flushing, facial, and usually facial and neck is where a lot of people have it, but anywhere, flushing, itching, abdominal pain, brain fog, which I know we all like to blame anything we do on brain fog, but brain fog is certainly something that people complain about. It can be episodic or it could be every day. People could say, I have it all the time. That certainly can happen. So if it's not mastocytosis, what is it? So in the past 10 years or so, folks have realized that there's something else that's going on, and they're calling it the mast cell activation syndrome. Unfortunately, we just don't know enough about what it really is to say, oh, that's for sure mast cell activation syndrome. So it's all sort of a clinical, you know, it's almost guesswork. I mean, we put things together, it's probably 20 or 30 different things quite possibly, and there is not a lot of great research on it. There's lots of information. That doesn't mean there's lots of great research on it. Everybody with me on that? So we're trying. There are not that many folks who take care of it on a regular basis, and even those of us who do take care of it on a regular basis, it really is a trial and error thing because we're trying to characterize this and learn about what this really, really is. So again, mastocytosis is the more severe form of what can happen. Mast cells actually start dividing uncontrollably. It's not quite cancer, but it's almost, it's called a clonal mast cell disorder. It's almost quite like that. But then we have this whole group of folks who may have a high tryptase, or they may not, and I'll try to get to that in a second, but have all these symptoms of mast cells releasing all over the place. Okay? Now this is what mastocytosis tends to look like if it's in your skin. This is something called urticaria pigmentosa. If you actually go and scratch one of these things, it turns into a hive. Okay? That is present almost never in people who have the mast cell activation syndrome. This happens when your bone marrow is just full of mast cells. This does not tend to happen when you have that high tryptase or not a high tryptase and those recurrent nasty symptoms of itching, flushing, and abdominal pain and other stuff. So this is a bunch of pedigrees, okay? These are a bunch of families. And the females are circles, the males are square. This is no value judgment, it's just what someone did a long time ago. As you can see in multiple generations, and when it's filled in, that means someone's affected. And when it's empty, it means someone's not affected. And so what you can see here is this is already an old slide, and I apologize, but as of about 6 months ago, there are 26 families who are filled in. It says plus 14, because I just couldn't fit it in the slide anymore. And I would say now we're at about 50 or 60 families at this point in time, and 150 different patients who have a serum tryptase that's high, and it's in multiple family members. Okay, now that's not something that folks had recognized before, that you could come in, see your doctor who was astute enough to draw that tryptase, who then said, uh-oh, you may have mastocytosis, and you got the bone marrow biopsy and it was normal, and then you said, well, what do I do now? Well, in a couple of cases, another family member said, you know what, I've got what so-and-so has. It's not as bad, though. It must not be the same thing. Okay, boy, do I see that all the time. A family walks in, that's the sick one. That one over there, not us. That one over there. And we say, well, just do us a favor. Give us a blood sample. Let's take a look. And we have yet to find anyone who had a high tryptase at baseline multiple times, didn't have mastocytosis, and did not have a first degree relative with it. It just hasn't happened yet. About 4.5% of the population has a high tryptase at baseline. Again, just defined by where we say the cutoff is. There are some folks in these families whose tryptase is not high. It's a bit low, but they're carrying it because, for instance, they may have two children or three children with a high tryptase. So we know it's running in the family, and it doesn't necessarily run perfectly in terms of the tryptase being super high. It tends to be higher, even in those who don't quite make it over that threshold. And what do these families have? We call it familial hypertryptacemia in the sense that their tryptase is always higher. You always have some tryptase. That would be tryptacemia. This is hypertryptacemia, having a high tryptase level. And they can have issues with recurrent flushing, itching, swelling, and hives. That's what we think about when it comes to mast cell problems. But then lots of these family members have joint laxity, retained childhood teeth, scoliosis, other connective tissue problems which you would almost never associate with a mast cell problem. They can have anaphylaxis, bee sting allergy. They can have food issues that aren't necessarily allergy. They can have lots of responses to medicines and smells that can't be explained and get blown off by their physician on a regular basis. They can have episodic belly pain. IBS is number one on the list of what these folks have. Dysmotility problems from stem to stern. I'm trying to think of an appropriate term. But there is just trouble moving things along. They get stuff stuck in their throat a lot. They have gallbladder issues. They've had gallbladders taken out. It doesn't usually take care of the issue, but they've had gallbladders taken out, and a number of problems with moving things along. And then there is a substantial neuropsychiatric component of dysautonomia, anxiety, or neurologic and neuropsychiatric and neurocardiac, dysautonomia, anxiety, depression, chronic pain, and some behavioral issues as well. The key to this is that not every single person in every single family who's affected has every single one of these symptoms. I mean, it's just some do, and that's difficult, and they don't. But the key is this is being inherited. This is not something that you're acquiring at some point in time later on. Now, the story that I hear over and over and over again is, I was doing fine, doctor. I was doing completely fine until when I was 29 years old, I got into a car accident, or I got into a divorce, or I had to have surgery, or something traumatic. And ever since then, all of this has been happening to me. Does this resonate? Yeah, good. But the thing is, it's not just then that it started. Okay, this is running in a family. Their tryptase was high from the day they were born, folks who were affected with this. And actually, I just had a patient last week who came with her mom. Mom also had the high tryptase. They found it, before they come to us at this point, I asked just to get the whole family checked so we get the story of what's going on. And she said, I was completely fine until I gave birth to my first child. And then I've been having all of these issues. And I turned to the mom and I said, how many days of school did she miss when she was 8 years old because of belly pain? And the mom said, I can't count that high. Okay? So it had been going on, but you don't necessarily put it all together until it really starts to come on substantially. And it can. A traumatic event seems to be what gets it going. Now, of course, the problem that happens there is that since it happened after a traumatic event, the doctor very often says, it's all in your head. Bad. Don't ever say that. But don't ever say it is not at all in your head. Okay? If this thing, it's clearly both. We have definitely patients who've had substantial attacks right in front of us. They have their steroid. They put the steroid in the mouth and go, oh, I'm much better now. Steroid can't possibly absorb for about a half an hour. Okay? So, and it's not even, I think that's great. If that's what works, that's absolutely great. But we have to acknowledge that there is both a component of what our brains are making us do and a component of what the physiology of, we don't know exactly what's going on with this genetic problem are. Both of them are happening. It's very important to pay attention to both sides of it. This is just to show you that 4.5% of the population has a high tryptase at that randomly decided cutoff that's right there. And actually, if you take people who have high tryptase, now this happened in Austria, and I don't quite understand exactly how this study happened, but an allergy clinic followed 15,000 consecutive people, and I guess because they have socialized medicine, they just sent off a tryptase on 15,000 consecutive people and asked, what do you have when you have a high tryptase? So this is all comers. This is not you're coming in because of X, Y, or Z. They drew it on everybody, and they did a survey on everyone. Number one, this must be a translation problem. Meteorism. If you know what it is, then that's good for you. I did not, and it was one of those moments when you Google something and burst out loud laughing and have to explain, this is gas. And so we're all laughing, but it is not funny if it's happening to you. Certainly not to the person next to you in the audience right now. And then muscle and bone ache, swinging mood, vertigo, tachycardia, flushing, diarrhea, hypotension, abdominal pain. Look at that, okay? These symptoms must ring true for a lot of folks who are in here. So there's this amazing overlap between having this high tryptase and mast cell issues and having dysautonomic and POTS-like symptoms. And then somewhere in there is the connective tissue problems. I don't have all of the answers. I just am pointing out to you this genetic connection. It is a strong genetic connection, and we think it is an inherited genetic connection. And what I can tell you is that in the families who we are following, every single one of them does have exactly the same genetic problem. Okay? So we do know that it exists. I can't quite explain it to you yet because we don't understand it quite yet. It's in the same part of the genome, it's the same area. And watch that space, we'll find out. But that means there is a very focal and specific cause for why this is happening. It's being inherited. Why it looks like absolutely nothing in Jimmy, and it's a complete overwhelming, life-changing problem in Jimmy's brother, we don't know yet. But it does run in the family like that. It is there from birth. It's not magically showing up later on. Okay? Even though a stressful event certainly tends to make it worse. What do we do about this? Well, there is no magic. I don't care what the web says. I don't care what doctors A, B, C, and D say. There is no super great silver bullet. We haven't done a trial on anything yet. Nothing. We can just go by what people's experience is. And the experience most of the time is trial and error. The trial and error is taking antihistamines at Superman doses, Zantac, which is because it works as an antihistamine, not for the reflux. There's something called Gastrochrom, which was not used for anything for many, many years, but now appears to be helpful for some folks. That prevents the mast cell from releasing its stuff, in theory. Aspirin, for those who don't have bad stomachs, which is not too many, unfortunately. There's something called Xolair, which blocks the IgE, which is the antibody that sits on a mast cell and wreaks the havoc. For some reason, that seems to work, even though we don't think anyone's reacting to something specific when they have their problem. Doctor, what am I reacting to? It's not. It's your mast cell just likes to party, whether or not it's reacting to anything. Biofeedback, we definitely try to recommend this to folks to the extent that they can, because very, very often they will have events and think that they're having anaphylaxis, and then their mind takes over. And they will just drop their pressure, they will pass right out, and yet they're not anaphylaxing. They're not reacting to something. It's not their mast cells, but it's just a little tweak in their blood pressure or in some sensation, and their body just takes over and knocks them out. And if they take epinephrine, they feel better because it was your heart slowing down that caused the problem, so that's gonna make you feel better no matter what. I mean, it doesn't feel good to have epinephrine, but it will resuscitate you, so you might think that was anaphylaxis. 95% of the time, it's not anaphylaxis in our patients who have this. And then we have to work carefully with various different of our partners, or our medical partners, to work on the various other symptoms that are happening. It's really a symptomatic treatment so far that we are working on right now until we get a better sense of exactly what it is that is causing that. So again, we have a specific syndrome of high tryptase, mast cell activation, EDS-like symptoms, and dysautonomia in a dominant fashion, meaning every generation, boys and girls can be affected, 50-50 chance of inheritance. Many of these symptoms can be seen in families who do not have elevated serum tryptase. I see exactly this story in tons of families. This tryptase doesn't end up being high, but I couldn't possibly tell you without that lab who did and who did not have that high tryptase. And we have to watch that space to understand, is it the same genetic issue or not? We're working on it. We're trying to find the single genetic cause of this. And then in the meantime, it really is symptomatic treatment. It's not magic. We're going to try. I know that people get upset, doctor, you didn't fix everything, but we're working on it. So I will leave it with that, and we can talk about it at some point in time later.